Hi, everybody. Alan Arnette here with another podcast on alanarnette.com. And it is Sunday, April 24th, 2022. And obviously, we're going to talk about Everest 2022, plus the other 8,000 meter mountains that are being climbed right now. Take a look at what happened last week, kind of a big picture, what we're going to look forward to next week. And then I want to do just a little look back and kind of a retrospective, maybe a trip down memory lane for me, of the first time going through the Khumbu icefall. I tell you what, it changes your life the first time you go through that icefall. And I'll kind of walk you through that at the end of this podcast. So here we are in the third week of April. By this point now, you know, almost all the teams are already at base camp. They've been settling in this past week. A few have already made a couple of one rotation up to camp two, but most are still, you know, kind of settling in and just kind of getting used to the feel of things. This next week is going to be crazy, though. So if you look at the stepping back, taking a big picture as of April the 24th, that is today, that the Ministry of Tourism in Nepal has issued a total of 876 total climbing permits. And that's for all the various mountains. For Everest alone, they've issued 302. That's the total, 302. And that's significantly down from the 408 last year, which was a record. You know, two or three reasons for this. We've talked about this a lot. You know, travel restrictions coming out of China. The COVID took a real toll on the Indian economy and the ability for young Indians to get sponsorship. So that kind of cut both of them. Of course, the Ukraine situation has also caused some issues there as well. But this is an interesting statistic. Of the 302 permits on Everest, 72 of the 302, or 23%, are female. If you look historically, since 1953, there have been 4,524 individual people summit. Some of them have summited multiple times. That number is higher for the summits, but 4,524 individual people. That doesn't include Sherpas, foreigners. Of those, 674 are female, or 16%. This year, we see it at 23%. So clearly, there's been an uprise over the last, well, many years. It's been very slow and gradual, but we're seeing more and more female climbers on Everest. In terms of the country representation on Everest, it's still about the same as it was. The U.S. has the most, but 63. U.K. was 33. Nepal, non-Sherpas, in other words, Nepalis that are climbing, 20. India, 22. Canada, 17. Russia has 16. France, 12. China, 10, and Austria with 10. And this is another thing I found pretty interesting, that of all the, I think there's 73 countries that have at least one member on Everest this year, 73. Only 37 only have one person. So you talk about pressure. All right, so your job is to go climb Everest for your country. And so I tell you what, those folks have got to be feeling it. So, you know, obviously the best of luck to all of them. So always, you know, go check the blog. I get a lot of comments, especially on the YouTube videos, asking about questions. And I'm not sure people on YouTube understand that there's a blog that is a complement to these podcasts and these YouTube videos, but it's at alanarnette.com/blog and then backslash. Gee, what's wrong with me today? All right. So like I said last week, you know, there was a couple of surprises last week. First off, you know, everybody thought there was going to be nobody on the Chinese side. Well, not everybody, but, you know, the last few years, China has closed the Tibet side from climbing to foreigners and because of COVID. But they have allowed some of their national teams to climb. And so this year is no different. They've got two teams over there and they're both climbing. So best of luck to them to make the summit on that side. Another quasi surprise is a Ukrainian young lady, 33 years old. She's trying to climb to honor her country and to kind of bring inspiration to her country. So best of luck to Anatonia. And then people going through the ice fall like crazy. Oh, here's another one too, that Mark Batard, the France alpinist who set a speed record back in 1988, I think it was. This man is 70 years old. He wants to be the oldest person to summit Everest without using supplemental oxygen. But one of his other big goals is he wants to find a new route, an alternative to the ice fall. I've talked about this before. So he's there, he's working on that. So we'll see how much progress he makes on it. Another thing that caught my eye was a post from Seven Summits Treks. They're kind of the 800-pound gorilla these days on 8,000-meter mountains. They guide all of them, and it's not unusual for them to have 50, 75, 100 members on their team. And so they said they're going to start using biodegradable material for the prayer flags. And, you know, typically the prayer flags are made of nylon. Eventually they'll rip up and they'll get dispersed little small nylon pieces all over the place. So they've decided to, instead of having that nylon spread all over the mountain, they're going to use biodegradable material. And I think that is fantastic. Kudos to Dawa, to Tashi, to the whole crew over there at Seven Summits Treks. Now I'd like to encourage them to take the next step and really investigate how Denali and Aconcagua use clean mountain cans to remove solid human waste off of the mountains. I'd love to see that step because honestly, at the South Col and on the north side in the highest camps, solid human waste is the number one problem up there. So I think it's time for all of us to step up and do what we can to take care of these pristine mountains. I hear the internet is kind of iffy at base camp, you know, not unusual in the very beginning. It's a little unusual this late in April. Typically they've got the problems rung out, but if you hadn't heard from somebody, don't worry. They're there. They just don't have the internet connection, or they didn't get enough incel cell phone coverage, or they can't find that magic spot where you stand upside down, your head on top of your hand. And then you got to lean to the side, you got to cock your head. And then, oh my gosh, you get one signal and you can't move. So trust me, I'm not exaggerating too much. Well, too much there. Everest ER is up and running. Those are just doing yeoman's work. They provide free health care to the Sherpas, porters, Nepalis, and the members, the foreigners, pay a small fee. It's around $100, maybe a smidge more these days, to get health care service. They've already treated 157 patients. And they said the top diagnosis, as usual, is upper respiratory complaints and the high altitude cough, the infamous Khumbu cough. You know, that's the reason why you see so many people always wearing these very thin nylon buffs that cover their nose and their mouth. It has nothing to do with getting vaccines or COVID and all that stuff. It has 100% to do with warming up the air before it goes into your lungs, because that cold air that inflames the alveoli in your lungs, and that's what causes that Khumbu cough. And you know, that cough can be incredibly serious. People have been known to break ribs because they cough so hard. So just wearing that mask, yeah, maybe a little inconvenient, or the buff rather, maybe a little inconvenient, but you know, I'd rather have that inconvenience there than breaking a rib. I can't imagine climbing with a broken rib. Well, in fact, actually you don't. People are talking about going through the icefall. I'm getting different reports that there's anywhere between 4 and 12 ladders. And I don't know if people are counting. A lot of times the icefall doctors will lash 2 or 3 or 4 or more ladders together to cross a very wide open crevasse. So they may be counting those individual ladders and calling it, 12, when there's really only 4 crossings. So in any case, there's fewer crossings than there have been in previous years. So that makes the trip up to from base camp up to camp 1 a lot safer and a lot faster. And that's most important for the Sherpas now that are carrying the load of the work, carrying much more gear than the clients do. You know, as the crow flies, and I always find this interesting on these big mountains. We always typically think about how far you go in terms of kilometers or miles. But when you get to these big mountains, it's all about time. So from going from base camp to camp 1, it's only 2,000 feet only, but it's 1.6 miles, which is not that far, but it takes you 5, 6, 7 hours to go 1.6 miles. So that gives you an indication of how slow you go. On the blog, I've got the entire table there in the middle of it, going from camp 1 to camp 2, 1.7 miles, camp 2 to 3, 1.6. And then from camp 3 up to the summit, I don't have the exact mileage, but it's probably under 2 miles in total. So, from base camp all the way to the summit by the Southeast Ridge Route, we're talking about 5 miles. So why in the world does it take you 2 months? I think I talked about that in the last podcast with how fast can you climb Everest? And some people will say not fast enough, and some people will say too fast, and other people will say, I don't want anything to do with it. So totally get it. All right. Looking at the other 8,000 meter mountains, you know, things are all over the map there. There's a big, you know, cold front moving through the Himalayas right now, big high winds. You get a lot of reports about people just frankly stuck in their tent and listening to the tent, you know, flap all night long and keeping them awake. And yeah, I know it's annoying. I remember K2 just sitting there and just hearing that tent flap all night long. And eventually you eventually fall asleep from the pure exhaustion, but you know, then you wake up and it's flapping again. I remember Kami and I were one time on Camp 3 on Everest, and the wind was blowing so hard that it began to pile up snow on top of our tent. We had to get out of the tent in those gale force winds with a shovel in order to shovel off of the snow to keep it from collapsing our tent. Had the same thing happen to me at Camp 4, the high camp rather, on Denali a few times. So, you know, goes with the territory. Which means you either love it or you hate it. And so again, I'll never defend my love of mountaineering. I can only say that I do. Guilty as charged. Same thing over on Dalagiri. Carlos, my God, I'm pulling for Carlos with everything I have. 83 years old with a prosthetic knee. Now, Carlos and Sito and their six Sherpas, they're hanging around base camp right now, you know, still waiting for the weather to release over there. Mingmaji, imagine Nepal. Mingmaji is just doing some incredible things these days, you know, getting people up and down the mountain in a week. I mean, unheard of schedules. And so now they're getting ready to move over to Annapurna and also, I'm sorry, over to Lhotse and Everest. So best of luck to him over there. Who knows what rabbit he's going to pull out of his hat this time. Over on Makalu, oh my gosh, Adrian Bollinger sent me some really pretty photos. I'll put those up on the blog as well. He said they were making good progress until the wind hit. He says the jet stream is expected to camp over the Himalayas until the 27th. So that's about 3 days from now. So they're just going to hang around. You know, if you get a chance, go to Adrian's Instagram account. And he's got him skiing down, from Camp 1. And it is just this rock hard ice snow. And Adrian said he's not sure if he's proud or embarrassed of making that video. But nonetheless, he said, I brought my skis, so I'm going to use them. So totally, totally admire that, man. If you can haul them all the way up there, you better use them. Okay, so that's really about it. Like I said, this upcoming week, last week in April, typically this is when rotations are in full swing. I think we'll see a lot of traffic going through the icefall, not only the Sherpas, but also members going to spend at least one night at Camp 1, probably two, and then at least two at Camp 2, probably four. A lot of numbers are in there. So anyway, probably 4 to 6 nights above base camp. Some people will go up a little bit higher on the Lhotse face, depending upon if the ropes are in or not. That's one thing I haven't gotten an update on, or what's the rope progress going above Camp 2. Usually by now it's up to Camp 3, maybe even the South Col, but with the winds and things, maybe got delayed a little bit. Not too worried about it. They'll get up there eventually. You know, in some seasons, we've seen the ropes not hit the season until like May 10th. But I have to research that again and find out what the latest is. But, you know, somewhere in that neighborhood, but at the end of the day, they'll get up there and people will start moving up to Camp 3. The people climbing without supplemental oxygen. And by the way, there's quite a few of them this year. They need to get up and tag 8,000 meters of South Col, ideally spend the night. Most people don't. They go up and just tag it and come back down to Camp 2 and call it good. But when you're climbing without O's, whole different game. And my, tip of the hat to you that, you are something special genetically and physically to be able to get to almost 29,000 feet, you know, without using supplemental oxygen. Good on you. Godspeed. Good luck. Okay. Let's take a big turn. And let's talk about going into the icefall. So this is kind of an amalgamation of all of my experiences. I probably have gone through the icefall between my 6 expeditions on Everest and Lhotse combined. I don't know, count, let's say 5 each. So that's 30, 30 round trips, 60 times through the icefall. You know, and each time I remember going through it, there's always this excitement. The big thing is that you go to sleep the night before, or you try to go to sleep. You crawl in your tent, you pull your inner boots in, you put them into your sleeping bag so they'll be warm. You pull your outer boots out of the vestibule, probably pull them into your tent so they won't get any snow in them in case it does snow overnight. And then you kind of cuddle up in your sleeping bag and you're in there, you're trying to fall asleep. But all you can do is be preoccupied by going up a 2,000 foot moving river of ice. Did I say moving? Yeah, moves 3 feet a day, a meter a day, and it does it in these jags. And when it moves, it jerks, that causes ice seracs to fall over and just, you know, all hell to break loose, basically. So you're going through it and you're laying there in your sleeping bag and you're thinking about this. You're also thinking about how deadly it's been, like in 2014, when 16 Sherpas were killed in the ice fall from a ice serac that released off of the west shoulder of Everest. You think about people, you know, here even recently, the young Sherpa who just sat down and passed away at the football field. So you know it's deadly. It kills members, it kills Sherpas, doesn't care your nationality or how experienced you are. It's totally random. And you know speed is your friend. So you're laying there in your sleeping bag and you're thinking about all of this. So you, all of a sudden, you begin to hear the stoves hissing over in the cook tent, and maybe the alarm goes off, you know, on your watch, on your phone, something to wake you up around 3 o'clock in the morning, maybe 2 o'clock. And you begin to get dressed. And it just amazes you. Something that you could do in 10 minutes at home takes half an hour there at 17,500 feet in the at Everest Base Camp. But, you know, you take your time. You let it sink in, the experience that you're about to go through. You put everything on, including your everything. You know, your base layers, your long underwear, your down, not your down suit at this point, but just your overall clothes and your layers, and probably hard shell Gore-Tex pants, down jacket, probably Gore-Tex shirt or jacket, because it's, you know, it's cold. It's probably, I don't know, 10 degrees Fahrenheit. So it's pretty cold. And, you know, put your hat on, your gloves on, put your harness on. You pull on your 8,000 meter boots, you know, double boots. So you've got to, you know, take care and zip them up, unless they use the new style, the Bora type of attachment to, you know, get your laces, to tie up your laces. Can't even think of the word, right? Anyway, so then you put your, you know, your gloves on and you head over to the dining tent. You grab your pack as you're leaving, because that's got a few things in it, probably some mittens, maybe an extra down layer, water, and maybe some snacks to eat along the way, because, you know, you really want to stay hydrated and you want to eat 200 or 300 calories every couple of hours at a minimum to keep your body topped off. Pull into the dining tent. They got, you know, the lights are on. The Sherpas have already got coffee there, hot water. Make your favorite Nescafe coffee. and then you probably add this piece of toast with some jelly on it. Maybe the cook has brought in either scrambled eggs or more likely just a hard boiled egg. And you sit there with your 8,000 meter boots, your knees are up kind of high, you know, and you're kind of in all this gear. So you feel like the, you know, Pillsbury Doughboy, and you're just in there kind of quiet. One by one, your teammates come in, everybody comes in, everybody's quiet. Nobody, you know, 2-3 o'clock in the morning, conversation's not of high priority. Then all of a sudden you start to hear more and more, you know, noise outside the dining tent, and it's all the personal Sherpas coming over, and they're going to collect us one by one. So you really feel like a kindergartner in some ways, just as child. But, you know, now begins the magic part. So you've eaten your egg, toast, you've had a little bit of coffee, you probably didn't eat as much as you should, but you don't want to eat too much because your body can't move yourself and metabolize food all at the same time. So you don't want to have this huge overflowing breakfast of, you know, pancakes and bacon and eggs. You can do that when you get back. So then you go past the Puja altar. And remember, this Puja altar is got burning juniper next to it that'll stay burning for the entire time that someone from the team is up on the mountain. And you go by and the smoke is coming up and you smell that juniper. And so you take it and you just take your hand, your right hand, your clean hand, and you just whiff it 3 times over your face to let that smoke come in. You don't inhale it, just kind of do it this way. And we each time, a silent prayer goes up that, you know, for safety of you and your Sherpas and the teammates and everybody on the mountain. And then you start walking. I remember following Kami, walking through base camp, and, you know, it's kind of a maze. Depending upon where your camp is, it can be close to Crampon Point or it can be far away. Typically ours was far away. So it was maybe a 20-minute walk. You know, 20-minute walk, 3 o'clock in the morning, you glance up at the icefall and all you see is this line of headlamps and they're moving. And you know, it's the hardworking Sherpas ferrying gear up to the higher camps. So you keep moving, following the leader, your Sherpa, past a couple of yaks that are standing there sound asleep. You make sure, never touch a sleeping yak. Learned that the hard way one time. You know, don't pet the yaks. So eventually you'll make it, you know, past all the other sleeping tents. And you're, you know, be respectful, be quiet of the other people in camp. So you don't want to be talking too loudly, if at all. Honestly, you don't really have the energy and you're so focused on the job at hand, you don't really feel like talking. You get to crampon point, take off your pack, grab your crampons, you put them on, buckles always on the outside so they don't accidentally get unhooked. Pull your laces on around them, depending on what kind of crampon system that you have. And you're on one knee and you're bending over, you're putting the crampons on. You're looking around and everybody else is doing the same thing. So eventually you get those crampons on and then you follow the leader, start heading up. You know, the first part of the Khumbu icefall is surprisingly steep. It kind of starts off flat. It's really deceptive. And there may be even running water. In recent years, there's been running water year round at Everest Base Camp. And I've seen people actually step into a pool of water and their day is over because their 8,000 meter boot is totally wet. So they've got to retreat back to base camp. So you want to be really careful about where you step. At this point, there's no rope. So you just go, and after a little while, you come upon, now all of a sudden you see the very end of a white nylon rope. Well, this baby's going to go all the way to the top, and it's going to be your best friend now for the next several weeks. So you take your Jumar out and your safety, you clip it onto there. It's really loose because it's just a rope flopping around, and then you start heading up. All of a sudden, it just takes this big jump up. I mean, it goes up, it's probably, you know, 45 degrees, which is pretty steep on a mountain. And now you're in your crampon, you've got your ice axe, you've got your headlamp on, your helmet on. All you can really see is the ground in front of you because it's still dark. It's maybe now 3:30 in the morning. Well, welcome to the icefall. Now you're climbing. So now you go through the icefall, up and down, and it's just continuous. And eventually you'll get to a point where maybe you take a sharp left turn to go traverse across it in order to avoid a deep, deep crevasse that the icefall doctors couldn't put a ladder across. So you take this way. Now you're going sideways and you're thinking, I am not getting any higher. This is against the rules. But there's wisdom in how the icefall doctors do this. They've done it forever and 20, 30, 40, 50 years. So they really have a lot of institutional knowledge about it. Plus, these days they're getting help from, you know, drone photography and other people that that have seen it. And you know, that's why Mark Batard is trying to find an alternate route, because there's really a high level of science in putting that route through the icefall. So you're going through again, up and down. Maybe you come upon your first ladder after an hour, maybe 2 hours, depending upon the season. This year sounds like with so few ladders that it may be, you know, well into the climb before you hit that first ladder. You see that first ladder, and you know, the first time you see it, there's a little cognitive dissonance going on. Your brain's not quite processing exactly what you're seeing. So here it is in the middle of a glacier. There's this crevasse, which may be, I don't know, 2, 3, 4 meters, you know, 20, 30 feet across, and you've got 2 or 3 ladders lashed together. There's a couple of safety lines on either side of it. It's a fixed rope, but there's safety lines now. So the protocol is that whoever's going across first, the other person grabs the safety lines and pulls them taut so that there's more traction for that person to go across with their Jumar and with their hands. Some people put their hands behind them and other people put their hands in front. Some people just by the side. That's my preference. So you go on it and the first thing you do is you step onto the first rung and you hear this metallic clank. Okay, I got one step on. Then you take another step. Clank, clank, clank. And then about halfway through, you pause for a second because you realize you haven't taken a breath for 10 steps. And now you're, you know, struggling for breath. You look down and this is a big mistake. You look down and it's still dark, but your headlamp illuminates enough of that crevasse that you realize it's deep. That baby's deep. You don't want to fall here. Don't fall here. Clank, clank. Few more steps. Now you're focused. And now you've got the rhythm. You put your front crampons on the rung in front of you to let the back of the crampon attach to the previous rung. and then you just alternate your feet going across. You know, you watched your Sherpa go ahead of you, and he took two or three rungs at a time. Show off. These guys are so strong. It just, you know, it just makes us mortal humans look weak. But we go across, and then this mortal human makes it across. You get to the other side, and the commie looks at you and just doesn't really say anything. You're looking for, well done. That was the best I've ever seen. You're miraculous. You're wonderful. Nah, none of that. He just looks at you and he just starts going off, just taking off. So now you're clipped into the fixed rope. You've gone past your first ladder and now you're into a rhythm. I mean, you're just kind of going. And again, speed is your friend. When I say going, I'm talking about step, step, step. And what's amazing is once you get acclimatized, then it turns into step, 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 step. And you'll cut the time the first time going across. It's not unusual for people to take 6 to 8 hours. Garrett Madison told me that his team made it to 5 hours, which is, you know, which is wicked fast this year. I think that's more of a testament to do with how few ladders there are. But, you know, they'll probably do it now in 4 hours, maybe even 3.5 when they go up for their final summit rotation because they'll be, you know, so acclimatized. Sherpas will get through the icefall in 2 hours. Yeah. Exactly. So you're going through and now, you know, it gets even steeper and steeper. Eventually you get to a section called the football field, relatively flat section. That's typically where you take a decent break, you know, maybe half a liter of water, 200 or 300 calories in, you know, using a honey singer or whatever your favorite, you know, energy bar is. Sit down, sit on your pack, take a good solid break. You know, maybe 15 minutes, no longer than that, because you really don't want to hang around the ice fall very long. But this is a relatively safe place from objective danger coming off the west shoulder. Even over on Noopsy, there have been avalanches coming off of Noopsy that have come into the ice fall. That's one reason I'm a little skeptical that the Batard route, you know, will play out. But again, I wish him total luck and I hope he's right. Leaving a football field. Now you're kind of, you know, got a little energy into you, you're rested, a little liquid, a little hydration, a little calories. And so now you keep going. And, you know, by this point, typically at this point in the season, in late April, it's crowded. I mean, you may have 200 or 300 people, mostly Sherpas, carrying gear. And now at this time, it's getting close to like 5 o'clock in the morning. And a lot of times you'll see the Sherpas coming back down. I mean, they left base camp at 1 a.m., they went up, deposited their loads, and now they're heading back down. And they want to be back down in time to get breakfast. So you're still heading up and they're coming down. And you know what? They always have the right of way. So move off the trail, unclip, let the guys go by, you know, thank them and let them keep on going. So at this point, you may have a lot of people in front of you, a lot of people behind you. If you come upon another set of ladders, could be a bottleneck because almost everybody takes a moment to pause, you know, to make sure they're clipped into both safeties with their Jumar and their carabiners. So a carabiner on each of the safety ropes, your left and your right. And then when you go across, this is the time to be focused, really not the time to hurry because people have fallen off these ladders and people have been unclipped. And human error is what causes most deaths in these things. And so they've been known to fall off. But, you know, I've seen people fall off that were still clipped into the line and, you know, somebody else had to come onto the ladder and help pull them back up to, onto the ladder. It's a serious thing. So you don't want to be, you know, don't want to be careless. You don't want to rush it. So as a result, it creates some bottlenecks. You may stand there with, you know, 10 people in front of you, and it may take 20 minutes for that to clear out. Such is what it is these days on climbing a mountain like Everest. Yeah. So that's why, you know, if you don't like the crowds in Everest, there's, you know, 18 other routes other than the normal north and south that are wide open. And I guarantee you there's no people and there's no ladders, no ropes either. You're on your own. So just, you know, pros and cons, everybody to their own. So you got through there, you got through maybe that next ladder, maybe there's another ladder ahead of you. And then you get near the top of the icefall. And oh my gosh. Oh my gosh. As you're approaching that top of the icefall, you start to see these towering racks. I mean, this looks like somebody built an edifice, a building that's maybe, you know, maybe 3 meters wide by 10 meters high. And I remember in 2016 that Kami and I were getting near the top of the icefall. And it gets really broken at the top of the icefall because that's where the glacier, the river of ice is now starting to fall down this gully. And so it falls at different speeds. And that's what creates these crevasses. And I remember Kami and I were approaching the top of this broken up area. And there was this giant serac. Tommy was in front, as usual, and I was behind him, as usual, tried to keep up. And all of a sudden, I heard this, just this boom, giant crash. Well, a 10-meter serac, ice serac, had collapsed onto the route just seconds after we had gone by. If we had been there, I wouldn't be here. And I remember being hit by shards coming off of that collapse when it hit, that impact, just sending shards all over the place. And I remember looking at Tommy. He looked at me once again. He didn't really say anything. And we just kept on going. You know, I always call it the Bigfoot look. I don't know if you've ever seen one of these Bigfoot, you know, videos where, you know, Bigfoot's walking along and all of a sudden he looks over his shoulder, you know, at supposedly at the camera person, and he looks back. Well, that's what Tommy does all the time. He looks over his shoulder and gives you that Bigfoot look. So, you know, all I'm taking for that is that he's looking after me. I'm following him. We're a team. We're going to go to the top together. And we did. And so you get there, and that broken area at the top of the ice fall is just incredible. I mean, this is Mother Nature at her best. It's like ice sculptures all over the place. Ice fall doctors have just done yeoman's work again, just, you know, winding through this path. You probably go down maybe, you know, 10 or 20 meters and then back up 10 or 20 meters. Sometimes you'll go again crisscross. There's ladders going up. You're not necessarily crossing over an open crevasse, but now you're using a ladder to crawl up. You know, you could ice climb, but the ladder certainly makes it faster. And again, speed is your friend. You know, no embarrassment climbing a ladder in the ice fall. I want to get to the Western Coombe as fast as possible. So that part is kind of like a playground. I mean, just doing everything. You know, I keep expecting to see a merry-go-round or a swing set up there. You know, come on, let's have it. Let's play. But oh my gosh, it's just incredible what the scenery is, and how, you know, the crevasses are so open and just this jigsaw and this maze of ice. And it's like you take, you know, the big ice boxes, cubes of ice, and shake them all up. And some are still frozen and stuck together. Other ones have this opening to them. And it's just, you know, you just want to shake this thing again. 2015, it was shaken a lot with the earthquake, and that's when it destroyed the route. And that's when we were up there. I was up here at Camp 2. We ended up having to have helicopters to take us out because we couldn't get down through the ice fall because it was shaken so hard. Now everything was unstable, and it'd be suicide to go through it at that point, you know, especially, you know, a couple of days after the earthquake. Eventually, you get to the very top of the ice fall. And then there's this incredible, miraculous scene that just unfolds in front of your face. The sun now is coming up over the top of Lhotse. It's probably around 6:30 in the morning is sunrise. You know, you want to climb that ice fall when the sun doesn't hit it, because the sun's going to warm it up and cause those seracs to become even more unstable. Now you're at the top of the ice fall, kind of out of the danger zone, if you will. So then the sun comes up, and hopefully you thought about this ahead and you have your sunglasses, your glacier glasses on a string around your neck. So all you got to do is pull them out and put them on, along with a little sun cream on your face if you hadn't put it on already. Sometimes you forget about all that. And so you got to pull off and pull it out of your pack and put them on. But the sun feels great. And it also feels great to take your first steps now into the Western Coombe. And we'll cover that later. Climb on. This is Alan. And remember, memories are everything.